Let us say amen.
Amen.
Amen. We started a sermon this morning. We gave half of the sermon. We gave the first part, and we want to conclude with the second part this afternoon. In the book of Mark, Mark chapter 2, we're looking at a very familiar text, beginning with verse number 1, Mark chapter 2. We ask that you return your Bibles. Pray that you have your Bibles with you and that you bring your Bibles to church. Amen.
Amen.
And so you need your Bible so that you can mark in your Bible. Amen. Make notes in your Bible. Because we've asked that you not do that with the Bibles in the pews. Amen. Amen. So you need to have your own Bible with you. But if you didn't bring one today, you should be able to find one near you. Turn it to Mark chapter 2. For those of you who are still, amen, still studying the Bible, becoming familiar with it, Mark is one of the gospel books. Amen. Of the New Testament.
All right.
This is the second book of the New Testament, Matthew and Mark. Amen.
All right.
Amen. So it's after Matthew and before Luke.
Amen.
Yes. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, four Gospels. I said you would turn to Mark chapter 2. And we're going to be reading from a New American Standard Bible, beginning with verse number 1. We're going to read through verse 5. I'm going to ask that as soon as you can, get your Bible and read all of chapter 2, for it does make up the background what we're going to be talking about. Amen. Still here. A few pages turning, so I want to give you a chance to get there so you know that I'm preaching not of opinion, but out of the principles that we find in the Word. Amen.
Amen.
So yes, give you time to turn. I still hear pages turning. God bless you. Keep on going until you get there. Those of you who are ready, wait. God bless you. The Bible said, those who wait on the Lord renew your strength. All right. If you're there, we're ready. It starts in verse number 1, Mark chapter 2. It says, when he had come back to Capernaum, several days afterward, it was heard that he was at home, and many were gathered together, so that there was no longer room, not even near the door, and he was speaking the word to them. And they came bringing to him a paralytic, carried by four men, being unable to get to him because of the crowd. They removed the roof above him, and when they had dug an opening, they let down the pallet on which the paralytic was lying. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven. Son, your sins are forgiven. As this morning, we want to talk to you from the subject, just from the Word of God, straight from the Word of God, which says your sins are forgiven. Your sins are forgiven. Let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come thanking you for your goodness, grace, and mercy toward us. Lord, we're grateful for this chance, this opportunity to worship, especially now as we stand to declare your word. As always, we confess that we're powerless to do anything without you, especially significant to the cause of Christ. Bless now, as only you can, according to your will, and use us to preach your word. Lord, help us to do it with accuracy, with boldness, and with passion. And Lord, we pray that it would go forward with your blessings upon it, that as we receive it, we'll be different from when we came. Bless us now as we go forward in worship. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Lord, you are strength and our redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray, and every heart say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Your sins are forgiven every once in a while. For those of us who are committed to Christ, need to be reminded that God had to look over our sins and erase our sins and to remove our sins in order to bless us with relationship and eternal life. Are y'all praying with me? And then certainly every so often and all of the time, those who are yet unconvinced and unconverted, that you need to know that the only way that you're going to be in right relationship with God, the only way you're going to be connected with him is to have your sins be forgiven through the blood of Jesus Christ, blood of the everlasting covenant. You can't fix yourself. You can't straighten yourself out. The only thing you can do is receive the gift, the free gift that God has given to all humankind through the person and through the work of his son, Jesus Christ. And the Bible talks about in this text that I read to you is talking about Jesus Christ. It's talking about the fact that he has come home to Capernaum. And in the text, it tells us that he comes home, which suggests to us that Jesus' new home had moved from Nazareth now to Capernaum. And either that was his actual home or house that he was coming home to, or it was the home of one of his disciples, mainly the Apostle Peter. Are y'all praying with me? Amen. And as we look at the text, it says that Jesus comes home, and it was noised abroad in the King James Version. It was broadcast outside of the house and outside of the home base that he came to, that Jesus was in the house. Are y'all going to pray with me? And one of the things that we need to know is that as the people of God, those of us who are committed, can I talk to the committed folks here for a moment? Those of us who are committed to Christ and committed to the cause of Christ, we need to be about noising and broadcasting the fact that Jesus has come, and that he is in the house, and that he is offering salvation to those who would put their faith and their trust in him. It's not enough for us to come and enjoy one another in the house, but when we leave the house, we need to broadcast and be a witness that we found Jesus in the house. And we need to take him to those who are yet unconverted and uncommitted. And look, the pew where you're sitting, look right and look left. There's some empty spaces on the pews. And those spaces will never be filled unless you broadcast and lift up Jesus outside of this house. Are y'all praying for me? Yeah, and not only that, but as we see, Jesus comes home to the house, and the Bible says that it was noise and broadcast so much so that people flocked to the house, they came to the house, and there was no more room in the house. Matter of fact, you couldn't get in through the house in a traditional way anymore, which is through the door, because it was so full up because of Jesus' preaching and teaching that was going on in the house, that people could no longer get inside. Are y'all praying with me? It's a packed situation, and because it's a packed situation, there is a man who needs to be in the presence of Jesus. The Bible calls him a paralytic man. In King James, it says a man who was sick with the palsy. In other words, he was paralyzed. Whatever the disease that had inflicted him, he was no longer able to carry himself around. Now he has to be carried around himself. And the scripture says that he's carried by four committed friends. Can I talk to the committed folk in here? He was carried by four committed friends, which makes us understand that there are some folks that are in his life that care enough about him to form a partnership that would bring him and usher him in to the presence of Jesus. And the reason they wanted to bring him into the presence of Jesus is because they knew that Jesus could heal him and deliver him out of his disease. Are y'all praying with me? And the Bible says that he was carried by four, and they couldn't get in the house the conventional way. And so when you can't get in the conventional way, you need to go unconventional. Right. And the Bible says that they carried him to the rooftop. And when they got to the roof, because they couldn't get in through the door, they began to tear the roof apart in order to lower their friend down into the presence of Jesus. I wish I had a witness in here. And it helps me to understand that in a partnership, there ought to be some committed folks in a partnership. Because it takes a partnership in order to get folks saved. Anybody here understand that? That it's not just about you. It's not just your responsibility as a mama and as a grandmother. It's not just your responsibility as a brother or a sister. It's not just your responsibility as a friend or a neighbor to make sure that folks get saved. But God wants to partner with you and some other folks to make sure that there are folks who get in the place where they can be in the presence of Jesus. So I had a witness in here. And it takes a partnership. And we find that they are working together, and they are carrying him. The King James Version said they're carrying him on a bed. And in the NASB, it says that they are carrying him on a pallet.
All right.
And however you look at it, whatever you want to call it, it's really a stretcher. It's like a gurney. And what happens is, in the stretcher, there was a pallet, there was a mat on there, on the pallet. It was a mat, and then it had holes on each end of the mat. And then they would stick a staff or a pole on both sides through the holes in the mat. And so now he could get on the mat, and four friends each could get on a corner. And then together, they could carry him where he needed to go. Amen. And so it helps me to understand that in this partnership that we find in the text, they were able to carry him because they had a partnership that was committed, folks. I said they were committed because they weren't letting anything stop them from giving their friend to Jesus. If it had been us, we'd have carried him to the door and said, "Man, I'm sorry, we tried, but it's full up in there. We can't even get you in the door. We tried. I hope you forgive us." But these brothers were really committed. And they wasn't going to allow the fact that the conventional way that Jesus was blocked. They went unconventional. And so the Bible tells us that not only were they committed, but they had the right character.
Yes, sir.
Because they weren't just about talking about friendship. They were about being friendship. They were being friends because they weren't going to let nothing stop them from helping their friend.
Yes.
But not only did they have a commitment and character, they brought some coin to that purpose. In other words, they were ready to pay whatever was needed in order for ministry, deliverance ministry, to occur.
All right.
Y'all don't see that. I know y'all say preachers always trying to bring money in the subject, but there's money in the text. If y'all might want to say that. There's money in the text. There's money in the text. Because they weren't just committed with their effort and their character and their labor, but they were committed with their coin. Where do you see that? Well, the Bible says that because they couldn't get in the conventional way, they went up on the rooftop. And they began to tear the roof away. And it wasn't their house. Y'all gonna hear me in a minute. Because if somebody come in your house and start tearing up stuff, you gonna want to check when they leave. Matter of fact, you don't want no any kind of check. You want a cashier's check because you want to make sure you don't get your money back. Is that right? And so they had to pay. And it wasn't a conventional roof. It wasn't like in the 21st century. It was a first century roof. And in the first century roof, there were beams on the roof. There were beams. And they were about 2 to 3 feet apart. And these beams, not only were there beams, but there was mud. And they would put mud on top of the roof, and then they would put thatch on top of the roof. And out of that mud and thatch, grass would grow through. That'll hit me in a minute. And so it wasn't no easy task to get up on somebody's roof and talk about you're gonna tear into it. Amen. But they were committed to getting their friend. And so if they tore up somebody else's roof, somebody had to pay for that. And so not only did they have commitment and character, but because they had commitment and character, they also brought some coin. But you know what? Ministry is not free. I know y'all think it's free. A lot of folk in here think it's free. Because it's free to you. I wish I had a witness in here. But ministry that's extensive is ministry that's expensive. Because every time we open up this place, turn the light on, AC, heat, whatever, amen, that's money. Are y'all praying with me? And not only if we try to feed folks on Thursday, that's money. Somebody's got to pay for that. Are y'all praying with me? And amen, if you're gonna do all of that and for ministry, whenever we do something for ministry, it costs some coin. And so if you're going to be involved in ministry, you need to know that you need to bring an offering. And a lot of times we have missed our blessing because we don't give to God's ministry as we ought to. Because the Bible says you can't give to ministry without God ministering financially in your life.
Yes, sir.
I know the Bible says that give and then folk gonna give back to you good measure, pressed down, shaken together. Bring the tithe and God said, "I'll open up the windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing, there won't be room enough to receive it." Yes. If you sow a little, you will reap a little.
Yes,
but if you sow a lot, God says you will reap a lot.
Yes, sir.